Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. I didn't hear anybody say. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
There we go. Everybody's awake. Everybody's awake. Everybody's awake. Everybody's awake. Come. We're going to celebrate the Lord.
Celebrate day. Celebrate day.
Yesterday was Independence Day.
Was Day. Was Day.
Was Day.
Was Day.
Was Day.
Was Day.
Was Day.
Was Day.
And
on July 4th, 1776,
13 colonies declared their independence from
Great Britain,
and
we became a
nation
under God.
So this morning,
honor that.
Would you all please stand?
Please stand.
We will have the pledge.
Be seated. When Jesus died on the cross for us and took away our sins, we declared our independence from sin. So this morning, that was a happy day for us. So let's sing about that happy day. a glorious way that you. Wondrous cross this morning is wonderful to us as Christians. It represents our sacrifice for our Savior this morning. So sing this, the wonderful cross, this morning. Chad Thompson, will you have our prayer this morning?
Many times when we come to the communion table, we talk about Jesus as a lamb, meek and mild, led to the slaughter, a sacrifice. It's all very true, but only in one aspect of the Christ. Jesus was more than that. As we celebrate the 4th of July, America's freedoms, and think about soldiers who paid the ultimate price, we do not think of these men and women as lambs and meek and mild, but we think of these soldiers as strong, trained fighters, soldiers on the attack who stand between us and our enemies, those who would harm us. We need to recognize this morning that Jesus, the Jesus we serve, was a fighter. He was a soldier also. All through Scripture, we have military terms that are used about Christ, about the church, and about us as Christians. Beginning in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, Jesus is the wounded warrior who destroys the enemy by crushing the head of Satan. Even in, all the way through to Revelation chapter 19, Jesus appears as on a great white war horse with his sword, with the blood of his enemies splattered on his white robe, victorious in battle. And as his followers, we also are told to fight and put on the armor and use the sword. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8 says, "The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil." And the mission statement of every sworn infantryman is the same, and I quote, "to close with and destroy the enemy." This is what Jesus did when he went to the cross for us. Descending from heaven, Jesus invaded enemy territory to rescue all of us who were held hostage by the enemy of our souls. Jesus came to set us free forever. He was the ultimate warrior when he squared off against Satan, the enemy of all mankind, on a hill outside of Jerusalem. There Jesus stood between us and all that would harm us. And this is the very definition of a competent warrior. He took the blows. He shed his blood. He gave his life on our behalf. This is the ultimate sacrifice that any soldier or warrior can make. Calvary, the centerpiece of the Bible, to which every biblical story points, is the scene of the greatest battle mankind has ever witnessed. In his death, Jesus paid for our salvation and freedom. In his resurrection, he provides us eternal life and a safe haven, a perfect home in heaven. Jesus, the Jesus we remember this morning, is the ultimate warrior, and he gave his life for our freedom.
Father, we thank you for another day, another week that we can assemble in your house to sing praise to you and to study your word and to meet around your table, to remember Jesus who loved us and gave us much grace that we don't deserve, Lord, but we just thank you for it. We thank you for this loaf which represents thy body that was broken. We pray that it will be strength for our spiritual souls to help us to work closer to you. Forgive us when we falter and keep us in your care. In Christ's name we pray.
We are thankful, Heavenly Father, for this day that you've given us and this opportunity that we have this morning to gather around your table and remember your sacrifice at Calvary on a cross. You gave your life and shed your blood for our sins. Lord, we're thankful for your mercy, your grace, your love that you have bestowed upon us. We're thankful, Lord, for this time. Help us right now to focus our hearts and minds on nothing but your cross and your sacrifice and your willingness to go to that cross and die for our sins. Bless this cup which represents your precious blood that you poured out for our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
from above, from the mountain to the prairie, to the ocean, white with fungus. Bless America, my home, sweet home. God.
Thankful that God has blessed America. Amen. And we are blessed to live here today and to be free to worship and serve the Lord according to His word in this nation that still stands for freedom. Good to see Herschel and Barbara Barker with us today. Herschel's been sick and unable to be with us for quite some time. I'm glad they're able to be here today. One who is not with us today is Shirley Burnett. I think she's down the state a little ways. Her granddaughter was crowned Miss Kentucky last night. So her great-granddaughter, wow, great-granddaughter was crowned Miss Kentucky. So obviously I don't know her, but congratulations to that family. Glad that you're here. In our last message from the book of Acts, we saw that Peter preached the first gospel sermon on the day of Pentecost, and those who gladly received his word were baptized. And there were added unto them that same day about 3,000 souls. That's really amazing when you think about that, that 3,000 people who had no idea when they woke up that morning that they were going to be baptized into Christ that very day, that that's what actually happened. And so the Church of Christ was born on the earth. But what happened next? Well, that's the topic of our message today, the unleashed church, Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 41 through the end of the chapter. Those who gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day were added unto them 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many signs and wonders were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Let's pray. Thank you, God, that we're a part of that glorious church we read about here in Acts chapter 2. Still exists 2,000 years later on the earth. And we're thankful that there are souls still being saved, added to the church, even today. All around the world, the church of Christ is still alive and well. We pray, Father, that you will bless your church here at Coal Run and around the world, that people will come to know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that we can get that message out to people, many people who have never heard. And we pray that those who have heard the message will respond in obedient faith and be saved and be added to that church that we read about right here in the book of Acts. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Acts 2 clearly reveals to us how the church began and what the early church did. Today we want to imitate that first church of Christ in our church here and now, today. Now we do see churches all around us today that are a far cry from what we read about in the book of Acts. Churches have discounted the plan of salvation. They have discounted the Christian life. They have discounted the apostles' doctrine and the mission of the church. But Jesus has always believed in his church. He told his disciples in Matthew 16 that he would build his church and that the powers of hell, the gates of hell, would not, shall not prevail against it. He believed in his church more than anyone else, perhaps anyone else who's alive on earth today. Because the church is what God intended. Jesus did not come just to promote spirituality, just to get people to be more loving and more kind. No, he came to build the kingdom of God on earth and to save people from their sins and create a church kingdom that would bless the earth and that would fill the earth with people of love, service, and worship. He did not say he was going to build a bunch of Christians. He said he was going to build his church. And yet, we see people alive today, a lot of people today, who claim to love Jesus and yet criticize his bride, the church. And yet you cannot really love Jesus and have contempt for his bride, because Jesus and his bride are one flesh. This is a great mystery, but it is the gospel truth. Now, the church is not perfect. It never has been, and it never will be, because the church is made up of people who are not perfect, but have a perfect Lord, a perfect Savior. And not all people who claim to belong to the church are really in the church. And so the church gets a bad name from people who badly misrepresent our Lord and Savior and his glorious church, the one we read about in the New Testament. Now, the word church means the called out ones, and it refers to people who have been called out of the world and translated into the kingdom of his dear Son. And it is used three different ways in the Bible. First of all, it is used for the universal body of Christ on the earth, all over the world, the church. Secondly, is used for the Christians in one particular city, such as the church at Rome, or the church at Corinth, or the church at Coal Run. It is also used for a local congregation, like the church that meets in their house, the church in a specific area. But no matter how you use the word church, the church has always been flawed but forgiven and used by God for His global agenda. And faithful Christians meeting faithfully in a faithful congregation make Jesus look good. Not only do we make God look good, we make God look smart. Because Ephesians 3, 10 and 11 says, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. To the eternal purpose, according to the eternal purpose which He accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. Did you know that God is using us to display His wisdom to the angels in heaven? Angels that we cannot even see. So something big is going on here that we can't see. It's just like when you read the book of Job. There was a lot going on in the book of Job that Job didn't know was going on. All these conversations between Satan and God. He didn't know about it, but it was happening nonetheless. And when we work for God, and when we worship God, we are educating angels concerning the divine wisdom of God. And we are illustrating His glory. Because you read a little later on there in Ephesians 3, and Paul breaks out in this glorious doxology of praise when he says, "Now unto Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen." So what happened in Jerusalem may not have seemed very significant at the time. It did not make the newspapers in Rome. There was nothing about it on CNN or even on the Fox News Channel. But what seemed to be very small was the unleashing of God's very big intention to save the world. What started intentionally began functioning intentionally, because the unleashed church stresses intention. One thing you cannot miss when you read the closing verses of Acts chapter 2 is that the early believers were united. They were single-minded. They were together. The very first words you read about the very first church in history are these words: "They continued steadfastly." The NIV translates it, "They devoted themselves." They were intentional about certain things that would promote their own spiritual growth and the growth of the body of Christ around the world. And one of those things was they were consistent in their spiritual disciplines. Acts 2:42, they were consistent. And one of those things they were consistent in was the apostles' doctrine. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. They met together to learn more from the apostles about Jesus Christ and His will for their lives. And there is no difference between the apostles' doctrine and the doctrine of Christ. It's one and the same. The doctrine of Christ is the apostles' doctrine. The apostles taught the ways of Jesus Christ, and they tried their best to live what they taught. But the early church was devoted to meeting together so they could learn together the ways of Christ. And I don't think that that was limited to one 30-minute sermon a week. They also participated in fellowship. They continued steadfastly in fellowship, which means sharing together. They shared their money. They gave weekly. They shared their time. They shared their love. They shared their life. All about their life. They shared it. They also participated in the breaking of the bread. This is an expression for the Lord's Supper, sometimes called the communion service. Because Jesus took bread and broke it, and he gave it to them and told them to eat of it in remembrance of his broken body. And in Acts 20 and verse 7, we read that the early church met on the first day of the week to break bread. That was the purpose, the main purpose of their meeting together on the first day of the week. It was something they did every Sunday. Acts 20 and verse 7, it's right there. They also continued steadfastly in prayer. Prayer is mentioned 48 times in the 28 chapters of the book of Acts. You cannot have church without prayer. You cannot live the Christian life without prayer, because all of life is to be handled with prayer. And all of these spiritual disciplines were simply the response of new creatures in Christ, growing and maturing in Christ, because they were living their life under the influence and direction of the Holy Spirit. They were gifted with the Holy Spirit, Acts 2:38. And the Holy Spirit led them to do these things. Now, the question is, can you and I do these things? Yes. Should you and I do these things? Of course. If we want to be the Lord's church in the 21st century, we need to imitate the Lord's church in the first century. If we want to grow like the early church grew in the first century, we need to devote ourselves to being and doing what they were and did. They did all of these things steadfastly. They were devoted to these things. So they assembled faithfully at least one day a week. Have to ask the question, how faithful are you to the assemblies of the church? One time three preachers got together. They were discussing an unusual problem that all three of them were having. And that was, all three of them had squirrels in the attic of their church building. And so one of the preachers said, you know, we set traps in the attic and we caught those squirrels and we turned them loose, but you know what? They came right back. It went right back in the attic. The second preacher says, you know, we tried noise, we tried sprays, we even hired an exterminator, but we cannot get rid of those squirrels. And the third preacher said, well, I used to have that problem too, but not anymore. Another preacher says, well, what did you do? He says, well, I baptized all those squirrels and made them members of my church, and I haven't seen them since. Whatever works. There's a lot of talk today about the decline of the church in America, and there's a lot of truth to that. But really, it's not so much a decline in church membership as it is a decline in church attendance. Because we have so much money, we have to go somewhere on the weekend and spend it. So a different group is gone every week of the entire year. A different group is gone. It wasn't a problem 50 years ago. Some of you are my age. You can remember back 50 years ago. That wasn't a problem. Why? We didn't have that kind of money. Church was the only thing going, buddy. And we went to church, and that was all we... No other plans were made. That's what we did, because we didn't have the money that we have now. But people have it now. Add to that the problem of sporting events that dominate our lives, including the Lord's Day. Add to that the problem of one person being sick in the family and the whole family has to stay home and take care of that one person. Sometimes people stay home from church because they're afraid they might get sick. And then there's the weather. Oh, yeah, it's too hot, too cold, too wet, too slick, too something. And then there's family reunions and every other excuse you can imagine. But what is really behind all these excuses? what is behind it all. I think you know, and I think I know. A study was released recently of children of so-called active church members. And here's what the study revealed. The average child of the average church member actually attends church 1.4 times a month. 1.4 times a month. Which means the average child of the average church member is spending more time a week on video games than he spends an entire year in church. And we wonder why our kids are giving us so much trouble. I got this poem just this past week, a few days ago. Daddy had a little boy, his soul was white as snow. He never went to Sunday school because Daddy didn't go. He never heard the word of God that thrills the children's minds. While other children went to Bible class, this child was left behind. As he grew from babe to youth, Dad saw to his dismay that a soul that once was snowy white was now a dingy gray. Realizing his soul was lost, Dad tried to win him back, but now the soul that once was white had turned an ugly black. Dad even started back to church and Bible study too, and he begged the preacher, "Isn't there anything that you can do?" The preacher tried and failed and said, "We're just too far behind. I tried to tell you years ago, but you would pay no mind." And so another soul was lost that once was white as snow. Sunday school would have helped, but Daddy wouldn't go. Luke 4 verse 16 says this about my Lord. Jesus came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. My Lord and my example was devoted to weekly attendance where God's people got together around God's holy word. We cannot stay spiritually fit if we are spiritually undisciplined. And it doesn't just help our fitness, it helps our witness. Because another thing about the unleashed church is it is persistent in making more disciples. Acts 2:47 says, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. And we see this consistently throughout the book of Acts. In spite of persecution, maybe it's going to take persecution to get us going again. But in spite of the lack of television, radio, the internet, and satellites, they got the message out to the whole world in the first century. Why? Because Jesus had saved them, and they were commissioned by Jesus to take that message of salvation to everybody else in the world. And they did it. Many of the metaphors that Jesus used about his kingdom on the earth were growth metaphors. The kingdom is like a net cast out into the sea. It's like a sower sowing the seed. It's like a mustard seed that grows up into a great tree. It's like leaven that spreads throughout all of the bread. But too often today, we see the preference of the saved taking precedence over a burden for the lost. And nobody's against church growth. We just don't like it when new people come in and might take our seat. Did you know that there were only 20 lifeboats on the Titanic? Way too few. But even more tragic is the fact that most of those lifeboats were only half full because the people in the lifeboats were afraid of what might happen if they went back and picked up more people who were out there freezing to death in the water in the North Atlantic Sea. Listen, an unleashed church has a burden for people to come into the church, whether that is here or Pikeville or Zebulun or Ford's Branch or Elkhorn City or halfway around the world. Praise God, people are being saved and they are being added to the church wherever they are. Because we want to make more disciples of Jesus Christ. We want the church to grow here, but we want to grow everywhere. And then finally, the unleashed church is insistent that discipleship is a team sport. God saves everybody individually, but he saves nobody independently. God uses the church, all the church, to save souls. In our text today about the early church of Christ, not one individual is mentioned. Every noun and every pronoun is plural. They, their, all. This reminds us that the church must always resist the spirit of individualism. We hear this individualism in expressions such as, I just didn't get anything out of it. Imagine a child saying to his parents, I think I'm going to change families. I'm just not getting anything out of this family. The early church was devoted to fellowship. They shared their lives. They shared their possessions. They shared with anyone who had need. They were together. They had a united purpose. They were one in spirit. This was a we movement, not a me movement. And so the church is not a place to where you go. A church is a people to whom you belong. Did you know that there are over 30 commands in your Bible you cannot obey without a local church? That's, you got to have a faith community. You need to be in a class. You need to be in a small group that meets weekly, where you get to know others on a more personal level. They get to know you. You can share life together. Your ups and downs, your ins and outs, your problems, and your blessings. You see, the early church met together to encourage one another, to serve one another, to rejoice with one another, to weep with one another, to bear one another's burdens. You can't do that on your own. So do not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. But let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Because the church does people better than anyone else in the world. An elderly gentleman in a Texas church cares for a sick wife every day, every night of the week, even though she doesn't even recognize him anymore. Except on Sunday mornings. On Sunday mornings, he has a lady come in and sit with his wife while he goes to church. And the preacher of the church spoke to him and said, if it's too hard for you to make it to the assembly, we could come to you and bring you the Lord's Supper and bring you a CD of the sermon. And the man said, oh, please don't do that. Please don't do that. I need to be in church. I need to shake some Christian hands. And so we're going to put this sermon into practice this morning. Would you please stand up with me at this time? For the next 90 seconds, I want you to shake some Christian hands. Give somebody a hug, a pat on the back. Be the church for 90 seconds. Be the church. Now, while you're still standing, we're going to sing an invitation song, and we want to invite you to be a part of this church. If you've never obeyed the gospel, you're encouraged to come today to repent and be baptized, to be saved, to be added to the church. If you are a member of another Church of Christ and desire to transfer your membership to the Coal Run Church of Christ, you are invited to do that while we sing this song of invitation, because, Lord, we need you, and he wants to use us. He'll get along fine without us, but he wants to use us. Will you be willing to be used?
Lord, I confess how I fall apart, you're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. I want to confess my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. For sin runs deep, your grace is more. Your grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I temptation comes my way, and I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Would you all please be seated and direct your attention to the video screen.
Sunday school when I was only 8, and every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I have a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Then another man stood before you and said, remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am the life that was changed.
One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. For I am a life that was changed.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so
thank Jerry and Sheila for 25 years of service here at Coal Run today.
Be seated, please. Jerry, would you and Sheila come up? Twenty-5 years ago, we're glad that Jerry and Sheila came. Back in June of 25 years ago, Sherwood borrowed a truck from Big Sandy Wholesale, and Sherwood, myself, EW, and I can't remember, 4 or 5 others, went to Van Sant, Virginia. Got there about 7 o'clock. I don't believe they were out of bed. And we moved them back down to Coal Run. And Jerry, the dinner that we're having today, we're having in honor of you and Sheila. We have something here that we want to present to you. Go ahead and open it up.
So I can be more timely.
Yeah. So we can get started on time.
We can get started, get done on time. Thank you. That is very, very nice. Thank you so much. No, it's not a retirement watch. I'm not finished yet. No, that's very nice. Keeps on ticking, yeah. That's Seiko. It's very nice. Thank you very much. Y'all didn't have to do that, but I appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Brother Steve Sloan has another presentation to make to you.
Something from all the different classes.
Okay.
It's 2 tickets, one for you, one for Sheila, to go to the Biltmore, to tour it, and also a little bit in there for your motel and seat.
Well, that is, wow.
That's so nice.
That is wonderful. Thank you.
Who knew that?
Bobby, where are you at? Right here in front of me.
Feel like I need to retire now. I'm not ready to retire yet, no.
We wanted to give everyone who wished an opportunity to say thank you and tell you how much we've appreciated all the work you and Sheila have put in here at Colerain. You've kept us going and grown our congregation, and we just appreciate you so much. So the only way we thought to do that was by having a card shower. So here's you. a bunch of cards to keep you busy for a little while.
Oh, yeah.
And we thought you might want to keep them, so we have an album. And we chose this album because of the words on the front of it. It says, "Life is not measured by the number of breaths we take, but by the moments that take our breath away."
After our benediction, I'm going to ask Brother Steve Treep to have a benediction and give thanks for our food. Jerry, you and Sheila go ahead and go to the front of the line.
Okay.
And I used to kid EW when we'd start praying for the food, he'd start moving toward the front of the line. And you all can do that. Right after the benediction, we'll be having our dinner over next door.